Please hang up and try again.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to another segment of Learning Through Mistakes. My name is Cristian Servin, and today we're going to talk about how to process arguments to a program. Usually when we write Java programs, we usually request information to the user using different ways, like for example, scanner, JOption, pane. Sometimes we just decide to declare the variables there, but one of the things that we usually don't do right away is to pass the arguments as parameters to a program. Back in the day, they were super popular when we deal with scripts or the old C programs. So today we're going to talk about how to process those arguments that you see in the public static void main. That thing that you see there is string square bracket args. Those are considered to be the arguments that you pass to the program. Another thing that we're going to discuss is two possible errors that we're going to find in case certain situations happen. One of them is when we discussed last time about when you have different formats, when you're trying to assign a different data type to an array type. In particular, today we're going to talk about strings and ints. And the second mistake that we're going to have here, on purpose, of course, is when we try to pass pseudo arguments to our program. So let's go ahead and start watching this video that deals with these two particular situations. We're going to learn how to process arguments by creating a very simple program that performs the addition of two arguments, of two numbers. Let's go ahead and type this small program. At this point, we create a very simple program that you can say that in line 3 and line 4, we declare two variables and assign it with the values 5 and 3 accordingly. Line 5 is only performing the addition of two variables, x plus y, and we assign that result into the variable z. The only thing that we're doing on line 6 is that we're reporting back the value for z. In this case, it will be 8, since 5 plus 3 is equal to 8. So what we're going to do at this point, I'm going to go to my terminal. One of the questions that we have is sometimes you don't see the terminal in Visual Code. For that, you will have to go under View, and then we can just click Terminal. For example, if I click here, Terminal, it will be disappearing. But if I go under View and then Terminal, then definitely this will show you the terminal, as you can see here. So currently, I am in the desktop. You can actually just type ls, and you can see here a couple of the items that are in my desktops. Here, you can see right away that there is arguments processing.java. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to compile Java C arguments processing.java. If I hit enter, this command will generate a arguments processing.class. If you can see at this point, this file was before here, before we execute the Java C. After Java C, it was generated the arguments processing.class. This is what we're going to execute at this point. This contains the Java code, the Java virtual machine code, which is responsible to run this program. If we run this program, we're using Java and then the name arguments processing without any dot anything, just arguments processing. This will basically give you the 8, which is a result of 5 plus 3. If we want to pass as an argument, I want you to pay attention in the following line of code. So here we have something called main, and then we have something funky called string square brackets args. So this, ladies and gentlemen, this is what we call the main method. The main method is basically the one that is in charge of running the program. This is the responsible to trigger the entire program that you're going to do. So this is what we're going to do. Instead of just having these values of 5 and 3, we're going to extract those values from the arguments. Now, the arguments, as you can see, we don't really know what the author is going to give us. This is a little bit dangerous, to be honest, because we're assuming that someone is going to give us when we call our program from the terminal. And what we can do, let me just demonstrate how this is going to work. We're going to call the function or the program
Java arguments processing, and I would like to pass here 5 and 8. Now here, 5 and 8 is 13, and it will give us 8. Of course it gives you 8, because 5 plus 3 is 8. So Java will basically discard everything that you pass through these arguments. And it makes a lot of sense, because we're not specifying Java to tell us what to obtain from those arguments. However, if we want to specify, that is very easy then. We can say the arguments that is our position 0, it will contain the very first value for x. And arguments at position 1, it will contain the second value for y. So at this point, we can extract these values at position 0 corresponding to the 5, position 1 corresponding to the 8. This is not correct, and let me show you why. So let's go ahead and save. By the way, I have noticed that some of my students, they have this situation. When you read this in code, I don't know if you can notice that there's like a dot there that is highlighted. That means that you haven't saved your program. So what I recommend before, just before you go and execute, you always type Control S or Power S, and that will save you your program, as you can see now. Now let's go ahead and compile, and let's see what's going to happen here. Notice the following error. We got another error that we already discussed previously. Incompatible types, when you're trying to give a string into an integer. Notice that on line 3, we are expecting a number, a whole number, and we're providing strings, which is an array of strings. We're going to talk about strings later on. But here, Java is complaining two times. It's telling you that in line 3 and in line 4, you have an error of incompatible types. You're trying to assign a string into an integer, and that will not happen. And of course, in previous sessions, we already discussed how to transform that by using a typecasting. Now, typecasting makes a lot of sense when you're dealing with, for example, primitive types. But here, we're using a string and we're using a primitive type, in this case will be integer. Here we need to do a little bit more work for that. There is a friend of us called wrappers. The wrappers, there's a big list in Java that we can actually go over them, but integer is the object wrapper that will help us to transform a string into a numeric integer value by using something called parseInt. Notice that parseInt is asking you to pass inside of the parentheses a string, which it makes a lot of sense what we're doing right now. So basically, parseInt is a friend, it's a method, it's a function that is contained inside of integer. So every time you see these dots in somewhere, that means that you need to request a particular method from the object that is to the left-hand side. So integer, as you can see, because of the capital I, is an object. It will contain some method called parseInt, which basically will transform whatever string you're passing as a parameter. I'm gonna duplicate that thing for line 4. Now, this mechanism would allow us to transform whatever values that we're gonna pass as the arguments. It will be initialized to x and y. Let's save, and let's compile again. And now I'm going to pass the arguments. The very first value, which is arguments at position 0, it will be 1. And the second one, it will be 2. So 1 plus 2 is 3. So here we recognize that we're going to need two arguments. Now, I want you to pay attention here. This is a big assumption that we're going to have. Because what happens if I call this program again without any arguments? Now we're going to have this problem. So the array index out of bounds exception is an exception that occurs when you're trying to access a value that is not in the range that we're trying to process. For example, I have nothing to pass. If you have nothing to pass, then where are you going to get position 0, position 1? For that, we need to use a mechanism to prevent this aspect by using an if statement. We can make a decision in this particular problem by using an if statement before we access line 3 and 4. The way we're going to fix this problem is to use an if. Happens to be that the arguments.length happens to be not equal to 2, because we're only using two values. If it's not equal to null, then we need to notify the user by saying Let's provide two values as arguments. That isn't the case. We want to prevent that exception. Now, we can use something called otherwise. If that didn't happen, then by all means, we can just simply execute this operations and give it that to the else. If you're not familiar with the if-else, you're probably going to see this in a different lecture. But basically, the if and the else makes a decision. And here, we need the decision to prevent a possible exception. Let's go ahead and save and run this program. We're going to go ahead and run this program with nothing, with none arguments. And notice that instead of having that exception, you're kindly suggesting the user, please provide two values as arguments. So here you're saying, hey, I know you want to use this program, but you need for sure two values. So otherwise, do not use this program. Okay, fine. Suppose that we're going to give these values, 3 and 4. Okay, fine. The answer is 7. So that will give us a more robust solution to this problem. And that also will fix that situation when people might give even 3 or 4 or maybe 5,000. But if this program only executes the addition of two values, might as well check only for two values.
I think this program that we just provide you here covers a couple of important aspects. The very first thing is that we compare the way we execute a very simple program, an addition of two numbers, in particular two integers, that we provide their values inside of the program as a hard-coded values, or we should call it static, but also just remember that the word static plays a completely different roles in computer science and in computer programming. Static in the sense that once you compile them, they're statically adjunct when you run the program in the compiler. The second comparison is when we pass it as an arguments, and the arguments provide this flexibility to have the user provide them in real time, in runtime. Now, the runtime or real time is considered to be when you are running or executing the program, you get information either from the user, from different behaviors from the system, from different variables that are playing important roles, GPS, different things. They're called real-time variables. So when you pass that information through arguments, which is very flexible, is very convenient, and very dangerous also. Dangerous in the sense that when you have information passed as that, then nothing guarantees you that the user will give you the correct values or the correct number of arguments. We're going to talk about that in more in detail later on in a different segment on cybersecurity. But here, what we're going to talk about or we talk about is basically how we constrain the behavior of our program. We use an if statement in order to handle that kind of situations. You may or may not know what an if statement, but don't worry, we will talk about that in a different lesson. I recommend to just take a look at the comments here. There's a couple versions of the if statement or a couple videos that might help you to understand what an if statement or conditional or branching in computer science means. So that is important because now we're going to start writing small programs that they have the flexibility to provide to the computer user to give you that information, but also at the same time give you this robustness when you write your program, make it more reliable. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time in another segment of Learning Through Mistakes. See you next time.